Well, good morning, church. We're so happy to have you here to worship with us. I want to invite you to stand.
Thank you. means we shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and He is me. This is my prayer in the battle, when triumph is still on its way. I am a conqueror and co-heir with Christ, so firm on His promise I'll stand. And I will bring praise, I will bring praise. No weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and He is me. All of my life, in every season, You are still God. I have a reason to sing, I have a reason to worship. All of my life, in every season, You are still God. I have a reason to sing, I have a reason to worship. Sing it out, all my life. All of my life, in every season, You are still God.
Can have a seat. But then we'll be inside. Also, missions conference is in 2 weeks. We'll have a potluck after second service. So we're going to grill some hot dogs. If you're attending, please bring chips or salad or dessert. All right, Pastor Michael, it's all you. You need this?
I don't need it. I'm good.
You have a double microphone.
A double microphone, that's right. Talking
does
both.
Work? It, does it make it extra loud?
It's a little echoey, but it works. Kay, it's good to have you back, and I was gone last week also, so it's good to be back with you. I got to tell you something. So last week, Amy and I, she had her 40th birthday trip out west in the Dakotas, and when we were out there, we ran into this family at kind of a random place and got talking, and they were Christ followers. It was a great connection. When they heard that we lived in Purim, they knew of Purim, and they said this. They said, "You get to live where a lot of people would love to live," meaning that we get this incredible, beautiful place to be, and praise God for that. Hey, one more thing to add to what Kay said. What we mentioned the last couple of weeks is we have a group of people that throughout the summer has been doing a series of children's outreaches at Krause Park. And we've been exploring the idea, what if we continue to do that kind of children's outreach into the fall and throughout the school year? And there's some cool opportunities to do that at the school. And if you'd be interested in being a part of that or knowing more or giving feedback, I'm going to meet with anyone who is interested in my office following the service. So after the service, go right down to my office, right down that way, and we'd love to have a chance to talk with you, get your feedback, and maybe dream a bit about what God might be doing. Well, I want to invite the ushers to come forward right now. We're going to receive an offering and go into a time of worship. And most of you know the drill. Stay seated while the plate's being passed. When it's made its way to the back of the room, Amy will have you all stand. If you join me in prayer. Father, we want to thank you for this morning and celebrate. You are the God over all seasons. And I know in this room, there are many seasons here. Some of us are full of joy and energy this morning. Some of us are tired. Some of us are in the midst of just chaos at home, ready for school to start. Some of us are dealing with tragedy in our lives. We have all different seasons represented here and reminded that you are the God who is still sovereign over all things. You're the God who is good. And Father, you are the God that gives meaning and filling to life. And Father, I ask for every one of us this morning that we'd have an encounter with the one true God, that fill this place with your manifested presence and give us a vision of who you are and your beauty. Lord, may our worship be honorable to you. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
You know, when I plan these worship sets, you know, praying through them, it's often way in advance of when we actually sing them. And I know the first song that we sang, there is an opener. I know there's a couple families in our church who are just experiencing extreme intense grief right now. Two that I can think of right now, and how hard it would be to sing those words that all of my life, in every season, you are still God. I have a reason to sing, and I have a reason to worship. But scripture, sometimes I've found, can actually be comforting in times when you're really in pain. I think of, you know, Lamentations 3, which I've quoted this many times in church before, but how all throughout that whole book, there's this imagery that I found comforting in a time of intense grief, where it talks about how God has dragged your teeth through gravel and broken your teeth in gravel, and like this horrible pain, intense suffering. Like the writer Jeremiah, he's crying out to God saying, well, you know, this has happened. It feels like I'm in so much pain. It feels like you're not there. But then he says, but this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope because of the Lord's great love. Or because of the Lord's great compassion, his love will never fail, and that his mercies are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion. And all of those truths, I think, were things that I found that in times when I did feel like, I guess, my teeth were breaking on gravel, or the imagery that Jeremiah uses, that it still is so powerful in those times of pain to draw to mind the truth. And therefore have hope because of the Lord's great love. We will not be consumed. That's what it says in scripture. We will not be consumed. For his compassions never fail. His mercies are new every morning. And so we just sang that song kind of about that. Like, you know, in every season, I have a reason to worship. And now we're going to move into a spirit of gratitude and saying, you know, God, I'm thankful. And I throw up my hands, praise you again and again. You know what? All I have is a hallelujah. Even if you have nothing else you can say, you can call to mind and have hope and just sing hallelujah this morning. Okay? Amen. I invite you to stand as we sing.
I got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end, and you never do. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. So all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. I've got one response, I've got just one move, with my arms stretched wide I will worship you. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. All that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. Ooh. Come on, my soul, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song, 'cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Oh, come on, my soul, oh, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song, 'cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Oh, we stir ourselves up. Come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song, 'cause you've got a lion inside those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. You are so good, Lord. Even when I have nothing, I sing my praise. Singing hallelujah, lift you up this morning. You are worthy. Thou, Lord, art high above all the earth. Thou art exalted. All God, for thou, Lord, art high above all the earth. Thou art exalted far above all God. And I exalt thee, I exalt thee, I exalt thee, oh Lord. And I above all the earth, thou art exalted far above all gods. Yeah, you are. For thou, O Lord, art high above all the earth. Thou art exalted far above all you up. Together, we exalt thee. And we exalt thee. We exalt thee. We exalt thee. Oh, Lord.
Return. Nothing in this world here on earth could ever satisfy. Thank you for that reminder this morning, God. You are God, you are good. We can trust you. That your mercies, your compassion never fails. We cannot be consumed by the grief, by the bad around us. And we can call to mind you and what you've done to us and done for us and have hope. Thank you for never failing. We trust you, Jesus. We love you. Pray for your Holy Spirit to do work this morning in our hearts of convicting and sanctifying, also encouraging and loving, counseling. Wonderful counselor, we need your help, we need your advice, we need your comfort. I just pray you would be in this church now and as we go from here. Give us humble hearts to hear from your word. In your name we pray.
Thank you so much, worship team. Also, Macy, this is your first time doing solo bass, so way to go. I'd like the kids to come forward right now. If you're new with us, you pray over the kids every week before they go to their kids' time. So come on up, kids. And Dan, we're missing one light yet on the right set, the left one. You got it. All right, if you join me in prayer. Oh, Father, we do look to the day when you return, when we get to see you face to face and all of your beauty, all your majesty, all your goodness. Give these kids an anticipation for that day. Bless them as they go from here. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. And one thing we always do on the second Sunday of the month is, you know, God calls us his family. We're called to love one another. So one way that we worship is in the way that we love one another. So we're going to take this kind of a few-minute intermission, which you can stretch, get a cup of coffee, use the bathroom. Don't grab the snacks yet. That's for later. But also a chance to go and greet someone. If you call Cross Point home, look for someone you don't know, introduce yourself, and welcome them. Take a few-minute break, then we'll come back together. See you soon. About 1 minute, we're going to come back together. Hey, Deba, can you put up the PowerPoint? Let's make sure it works. All right, we are going to get rolling. You guys, a moment to get back to your seats. All right, have any of you ever looked back on a decision and said this? If only I knew then what I know now. Because I know I have. Many of us have decisions about relationships that you made in the past that you think, man, if only I had the wisdom and the maturity and the knowledge back then that I now have. Might be a financial decision that if I had just known more back then, I would have made that decision differently. Maybe it's a TV show that you binge, that you, if I only knew the ending would be that pointless, you wouldn't have wasted your time on that. Yeah. Many of us have decisions like that, and the truth is, the past is always 20/20. We can always see clearly looking backwards. In the moment, we have limited knowledge. And we kind of make the best choice that we can in the midst of that. Wouldn't it be great if whenever we're facing a major decision, if we can look ahead and see how those choices would play out? That have that information to make a better choice in that moment? And the truth is, rarely do we have that. But there's something I love about God. You know, God is outside of time. While we have limited scope, God fully sees the past, the present, and the future. And from time to time in the Bible, God pulls back the veil on the future and gives us a glimpse of what is coming so that we don't have to wait to get that information later. We can use that information to make better choices right now in the present. We've been doing this study on a part of the book of Matthew, looking at the week leading up to Jesus' crucifixion. And in Matthew 24, by the way, I realize in your notes and on the PowerPoint, I have Matthew 25. Please forgive me. It is Matthew 24. In Matthew 24, verse 3, it says this. Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives. The disciples came to him privately. "Tell us," they said, "when will this happen? What will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age?" They want to know, well, Jesus, what can you give us insights into the future so right now we can make better choices? And Jesus answers their question and gives them a glimpse into the future. And we're going to be taking a look at that this morning. Before we dig in, if you'd just join me in prayer. Oh, Father, we celebrate this day that you've given us. And as we take a look at this, I want to thank you, first of all, Father, that on the most important things, you do not leave us in the dark. You give us all the information that we need so that we can prosper right here and now in our walk with you. And as we get into this chapter, Lord, I just pray you open our eyes to better understand the context that we're in right now and the hope that we have. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. So the context here is Jesus had just got done talking about the Pharisees and how the religious leaders, how they're so convinced that God is impressed with them, but they're completely missing the mark. And then Jesus starts addressing Jerusalem and how Jerusalem, the holy city, the center of the Jewish people, how much he loves that city, how he loves the Jewish people. But because they had rejected his kingship, judgment was coming. And this ushers in what happens next. Now, I got to tell you something about Matthew chapter 24. As I read different scholars writing about it, one scholar who's very well known, D.A. Carson, makes this statement. He says, there are few chapters in the Bible of which scholars have so much disagreement. There is much of the Bible that is very black and white, that's very easy to understand. This is not one of them. And I'm going to give you kind of a few tips as we go into it, kind of help us study it. The first thing we need to remember with this chapter and with anything else in the Bible is the context. That even though God has given the Bible for us and this message for us, God did not write this to us. We're listening in on a conversation between Jesus and his disciples. Real people living during a specific time and a specific culture. Jesus did not say, disciples, I want you to know this. And by the way, for those of you living 2,000 years later in Pearl, Minnesota, this is for you also. It's for us, but it's not addressed directly to us. So what we want to do to better understand it is we want to ask the question, what did this mean to the original audience? What did the disciples understand this to be about? And once we figure that out, we can better ask the question what it means for us. Now, let me tell you why this is confusing. It's confusing because scholars look at two different events that's kind of addressed in this chapter. One event is one going back to history. In AD 70, you had the Roman Empire went to war against Israel. They destroyed Jerusalem. They burnt the temple to the ground. Now, we don't think much about that event, but maybe here's a way of thinking about it. For us as Americans, we have key events in our history that we remember. I mean, we celebrate July 4th, Independence Day. There's some tragedies we remember. Some of us always remember December 7th, Pearl Harbor Day. Many of us, when September 11th comes around, we remember 9/11. For the Jewish people in the early church, the destruction of Jerusalem was one of those events. It was an earth-shattering event that the temple, the place that symbolized the presence of God, Jerusalem, the holy city, that God would allow that to be destroyed. That was a major, major event in the early church. Another event that we have promised in Scripture is one that has yet to happen. That's that Jesus will someday physically return to this world and rule forever as king. And we find this throughout the New Testament. Even when Jesus ascended up into heaven in Acts, the book of Acts, the angel said he will come back in the same way. We have in 1 Thessalonians and Revelation all this talk about Jesus coming back as king. So two events, destruction of Jerusalem and return of Christ. Here's the confusion. For Bible scholars, when they study what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 24, you have to remember Jesus had just talked about judgment coming to Jerusalem. So therefore, they're not quite sure what event Jesus is primarily focusing on. And there's really kind of two main views. I'm going to present both views to you. And these are views that on both sides you have godly Bible-believing scholars who hold to. And you are all smart, intelligent people. And you can kind of come to your own conclusion to which one do you think is going on here. Now, with those two events, both sides fully believe that Jesus is coming back as king. There's no question about the second coming. That is not in doubt. What is in question is, what is Jesus talking about in this chapter? One view is called the preterist view. And the preterist view views really most of the chapter, or this entire chapter, as he's talking to the disciples, talking about their near future event of the destruction of Jerusalem. The other view is the futurist view, and the futurist view tends to view this really as talking about the second coming of Jesus and the events leading up to that. And just kind of names to go with both sides. On the futurist view, you'll find more like David Jeremiah tends to have that perspective, Tim LaHaye with Left Behind books. On this side, the preterist view, you have scholars like N.T. Wright or Scott McKnight, and you have all kinds of scholars kind of in between who see both happening in some way. As for me, and you don't have to agree with me, as I look at this and look at the context, I think that primarily Jesus is talking about destruction of Jerusalem, with an eye ahead to the second coming. I think it kind of morphs in that direction as it goes on. But I said, I'll give you both sides. And said, you are intelligent people. Come to your own conclusion. Now, here's something about how to apply this as we get into it. I believe there's something that's very true for us, regardless of the position that you take. If this is primarily talking about all future events and the second coming, then that means we should pay attention to this, and we should take Jesus' warnings seriously. If it's primarily talking about what happened with the destruction of Jerusalem, then that means that the warnings that Jesus gives here, they came true. Therefore, all the other warnings that Jesus gives, which are often kind of the same ones about what it means to follow him and to obey him and to be prepared, means that we should be taking that very seriously also. Either way, it should prompt us to take Jesus' warning seriously in light of his second coming. So, we're going to start digging in here. We're going to break this up in kind of three different parts, and with each one give you both sides, and then I'll give you something kind of concrete that we can take home from that. So let's start reading in verse 24. Jesus left the temple and was walking away when his disciples came up to him to call his attention to its buildings. Do you see all these things, he asked. Truly I tell you, not one stone here will be left on another. Every one will be thrown down. As Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately. Tell us, they said, when will this happen? And that would be clearly talking about destruction of Jerusalem. What will be the sign of your coming? Now, both sides, a futurist views that as the physical second coming of Jesus. A preterist tends to see that as the starting of the kingdom of God with Jesus' resurrection, ascension, and the start of the church. And what end of the end of the age? Jesus answered, watch out that no one deceives you. For many will come in my name claiming, I am the Messiah, and will deceive many. You will hear of wars and rumors of wars, but see to it that you are not alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines and earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginning of birth pains. Then you'll be handed over to be persecuted and put to death, and you'll be hated by all nations because of me. At that time, many will turn away from the faith and will betray and hate each other, and many false prophets will appear and deceive many people. Because of the increase of wickedness, the love of most will grow cold, but the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. Now, with these two sides, if you're a futurist, you believe this is describing the events leading up to the second coming. That of wars, rumors of wars, false teaching, all those things culminating as we reach the end. And clearly, we see that in the world around us. A preterist views these as all things that were happening leading up to the destruction of Jerusalem. And all those things were going on back then. Now, one verse that really kind of sticks out is verse 14. And this kingdom, in this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. In our own denomination, when A.B. Simpson first started the Alliance, this was a key verse, and he took a futurist view on this, that Jesus would not come back until every tribe and nation, every people group had heard the gospel. And yet to this day, we have more than 700 people groups around the world who have yet to hear about the name of Jesus. Clearly, when Jerusalem was destroyed, all those people had not heard the gospel. That seems to be a pretty strong defense of the futurist position, but just to make things a little bit more confusing, a preterist views this and asks this question. Is Jesus talking about the whole world as we know it, or the world as the disciples knew it, which is primarily the Roman Empire? And in fact, if you look in the book of Romans, if you go into chapter 10, verses 16 through 18, Paul makes a statement saying that the knowledge of God is already gone throughout the world, as if he seems to think that this has already happened. So which one is it? You can come to your own conclusion. See, this morning is one of those mornings. I'll give you some concrete things, And I'll give you some just very black and white, full of conviction maybes. You'll really love me after this morning. But here's something concrete, though. Something that is true of both views. You know, Jesus says in verse 4, watch out so that no one deceives you. And you do find, right after the ministry of Jesus, leading up to destruction of Jerusalem, all kinds of false teachings. And we have throughout history, that's been the story over and over again. And elsewhere in the New Testament, you have 2 Peter, you have 1 John, the apostles' warning about all these false teachings that are out there that can totally pull us away from a walk with Christ. And I look at America and all the different worldviews and false teachings, and what many of us Christians do is, as people who are very immersed in the culture, we tend to just kind of go along with the flow. The messages that we see through the media that are so compelling, the ever-popular, follow your heart, do whatever makes you feel happy. It seems so good, and we tend to just so blindly follow. Even in the church itself, we have things that are not biblical. We have many church leaders who talk about how God wants you to be financially prosperous. If you just believe enough, if you have just enough faith, if you donate to their ministries and believe in yourself, then God will give you that brand new car, that brand new house, all that you want. And it totally rejects what Jesus actually says about suffering, that sometimes the call to follow him means that we sacrifice all worldly goods to gain him and gain his kingdom. And that's the information that Jesus is giving, is this. What we should know now is that we should carefully weigh every message that we hear. We should be people who critically pursue truth, critically seek truth. And even on Sunday morning, when you're listening to me, don't take my word for it. Study the Bible on your own. Critically think through what I'm talking about and match it with God's word. Because God's word is what's inspired by God. I'm just another sinful being here on stage. Because of what Jesus is telling us about the future, may it be people who critically seek truth. Okay, let's go back into this. We're going to start here. Where are we here? Verse 15. So when you see standing in the holy place the abomination that causes desolation spoken of through the prophet Daniel, let the reader understand, then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let no one on the housetop go down to take anything out of the house. Let no one in the field go back to get their cloak. How dreadful it will be in those days for pregnant women and nursing mothers. Pray that your flight will not take place in the winter or on the Sabbath. For then there will be great distress, unequaled from the beginning of the world until now, and never be equaled again. Now, pause a moment. Some of you are wondering, what in the world is this abomination that causes desolation that Jesus is talking about? It's from the book of Daniel, and disciples would have fully understood this. And the book of Daniel is just prophecy about this king who really kind of set himself up as God and who would seek to desecrate the temple. And they probably would have understood that to be, there was a Greek king named Antiochus Epiphanes who he set himself up as divine. He made war against the Jewish people, and he actually rode a pig into the temple in order to desecrate it. And that prompted a revolution. You may be familiar with the Maccabean Revolution. Hanukkah, the story behind that is all around that event. And Jesus is referencing that event and saying something similar to that is going to happen again. That's a typecast of a future event that would happen in the future. Now, a futurist sees this as a time in the future in which a temple is rebuilt, and there's an antichrist, a world ruler who sets himself up as God, who seeks to desecrate the temple. A preterist, what they see is that when the Roman armies were surrounding Jerusalem about to destroy it, they set up their standard outside the temple, outside the holy place. And that whole area would have been regarded as holy, and to set up a Roman standard that celebrated emperor worship and all these other pagan things was seen as desecrating the temple. So again, you can choose which one you think Jesus is addressing here. Let's get back to verse 22. If those days had not been cut short, no one would survive. But for the sake of the elect, those days will be shortened. at that time, if anyone says, look, here's the Messiah, or there he is, do not believe it. For false messiahs and false prophets will appear and perform great signs and wonders to deceive. If possible, even the elect. See, I've told you ahead of time. So if anyone tells you, there he is, out in the wilderness, do not go out. Or here he is in the inner rooms, do not believe it. For as lightning that comes from the east is visible even in the west, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. Wherever there's a carcass, there the vultures will gather. Immediately after the distress of these days, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, the stars will fall from the sky, and the heavenly bodies will be shaken. Then will appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then all the people of the earth will mourn when they see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he will send his angels with a loud trumpet call, and they will gather his elect from the four winds, from one end of the heavens to the other. Now learn this lesson from the fig tree. As soon as its twigs get tender and its leaves come out, you know that summer is near. Even so, when you see all these things, you know that it is near, right at the door. Truly, I tell you, this generation will certainly not pass away until all these things have happened. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. Now, two different views on this. A futurist sees this all very literally. When it talks about the idea of the sun being dark and the moon not giving light, I think back to there's a best-selling book in the 1970s, The Late Great Planet Earth, that really believed that this is describing the sky being darkened by nuclear war and all the fallout. When you talk about the Son of Man coming in clouds, that seems to be pretty clear talking about the physical return of Christ. When they have the verse about this generation not passing away, they view a generation being all believers until the time of Christ's return. That's the futurist perspective. The preterist, the way that they read is a little bit different. When you have that passage about the sun being darkened and the moon not giving light, actually it's a quote from the book of Isaiah, looking ahead to the destruction of Babylon. And it's the kind of language that prophets would use to describe a major event, a major disaster. And they would view Jesus describing a major disaster, likely destruction of Jerusalem, in the same way. The verse about the Son of Man coming in the clouds, this is one I'm still trying to wrap my mind around a bit, because it's quoting the book of Daniel. And oddly enough, the word coming here is a different word than what is used elsewhere for the return of Christ. And it's quoting this verse in Daniel, that in my vision at night I looked, and there before me as one like a son of man coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. He was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. All nations and people of every nation worshipped him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed. A preterist looks at this and says that this is not the story of Jesus coming to earth. It's the story of Jesus ascending into heaven and taking the position of authority, which they would say happened when he ascended into heaven, happened on Pentecost when the church started. Again, which one is it? I'm giving you both sides. You're smart people. You can come to a conclusion on this. But here's something, again, that is true either way. We see repeated throughout this section is talking about things that are going to happen that are pretty dark. Wars, rumors of wars, famines, events that are major disasters. And at the end of all of these, you have Christ being vindicated. You have the kingdom coming. Throughout the New Testament, we have the teachings that he will physically return as king to set things right for once and for all. One of the reasons Jesus is saying that is that when those hard times come, when persecutions come, they weren't supposed to be surprised. The disciples were never going to have the place of saying, wow, God, I didn't think this would happen. I didn't think that people would throw me in prison because of my faith. I didn't think that this hardship would happen in my life. No, Jesus is telling them that it was coming. And here's what often happens for many of us when we're in the midst of hardship. If we disconnect God from the situation, it's very easy just to assume this is never going to get any better and just give in to despair and give up. But the promise here is that in the midst of whatever hardship comes, Jesus is still on the throne, and Jesus is still going to make that right. Ultimately, what we know now in light of this should give us hope in the midst of darkness. And I know right now in this room, there's many of you who are dealing with immense suffering and darkness in your life. Some of you are dealing with family tragedies. Some of you are dealing with financial issues. Some of you are dealing with illness. Some of you are dealing with conflicts. There's a lot of you who are in a very dark place right now. What you need to know is those times are going to come. Jesus has made that clear. But they are not the end of the story. The story ends with Jesus winning. And because of that, we can have hope. I came across a story last week that maybe encouraged me a little bit with this. Back in the late 1600s, in Scotland and England, there was a Presbyterian leader named Alan Cameron. And because of his commitment to Christ and Scripture, he was thrown in prison. And in 1680, he's sitting in a prison cell, and what he didn't know is earlier that day, his son Richard had been fighting in a battle just a few miles south of there. And Richard was killed. And the jailer opened the jail cell for Alan and threw in the severed head and arms of his son. And the jailer kind of laughed and said, "So, do you know who this is?" And Richard just responded, "Yes, they're my son, my dead son." And you can imagine just the horror and the grief of that moment. And then he said this, "Good is the Lord who can never wrong me or mine, and hath made goodness and mercy to follow me all the days of my life." What would prompt someone in the midst of that tragedy to proclaim the goodness of God? Because he knew who wins in the end. He knows that suffering and death would not be the end of the story. And because of that, he could have hope and proclaim the goodness of God. Because of what we know now should give us hope in the midst of darkness. Now let's move on to the last part here. And by the way, we move into verse 36. Most scholars, not all, but most scholars fully believe that Jesus is now shifting into the second coming. And I'm going to take that perspective here. "But about that day or hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. As it was in the days of Noah, so it will be in the coming of the Son of Man." By the way, coming Son of Man, totally different word here than what was previously. "For in the days before the flood, people were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, up to the day Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them all away. That is how it will be in the coming of the Son of Man. Two men will be in a field. One will be taken and the other left. Two women will be grinding with a handmill. One will be taken and the other left. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know on what day your Lord will come. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known at what time at night the thief was coming, he would have kept watch and would not have let his house be broken into. So you also must be ready, because the Son of Man will come at an hour when you do not expect him." Now, one kind of note about what we just read, there's a verse here that many of you know very well, verse 40, that says, "Two men will be in the field, one will be taken, the other left. Two women will be grinding with a handmill, one will be taken, and the other left." Often that verse is used to talk about the rapture, which is a belief that many Christians have, some don't. There's a debate about, is the rapture biblical? The idea that before the return of Christ, he pulls Christians out of this world to heaven. There's a time of tribulation, a time of judgment, and then Jesus comes back. And this is one of the primary verses used for that. And I am not making a statement either way about the rapture, but with this verse, I do think that's often taken out of context. The reason why is, what is Jesus talking about before that? Talking about the flood and how with the flood, judgment came to people very suddenly. How people were taken in judgment. He's not talking about God pulling people out to a place of safety. He's talking about God taking people in judgment when they least expect it. That how when Jesus returns at a completely unexpected time, coming with him, there's going to be judgment. And we don't know when that's going to happen. We don't know if that's tomorrow. We don't know if that's going to be 1,000 years from now. If that's thousands of years in the future, every one of us will experience death at some point. And when we experience death, there's that warning of judgment that comes with it. But one thing that we clearly see here is that not everyone is taken in judgment. What makes all the difference? Well, here's the thing. What makes all the difference is the most important decision that you could ever make. Because the Bible tells us that every single one of us deserves judgment. Because of our sin, our rebellion against God, the verdict is guilty. We've been traitors. We've committed treason against God. We deserve eternity forever in judgment in hell. But what God did, because God loves us so much, he sent his only son, Jesus, that when Jesus died on the cross, he died for our sin. He took our judgment, and he offers us salvation. And all that we have to do is respond. Say yes to Jesus, to his salvation, and to his kingship. That's the most important decision you could ever make. And that makes all the difference as to whether you're taken in judgment or if you're saved. And here's the thing that we can take from this that is concrete, is that in light of his second coming, in light of this warning, it matters that we make the right choice in life's most important decision. And ask the question, have you made the decision to receive that gift of salvation and to follow Jesus? You know, we've just gone through chapter 24. So I give you two different views and probably thoroughly confused you all. And I would just encourage you on your own to spend some time reading this through and really kind of prayerfully considering, well, what do you think Jesus is addressing here? And there are a number of things I pointed out that regardless of whether you take a futurist view or a preterist view that this is about what happened in AD 70, there are things that are true for all of us. Now, as you wrap this up, this kind of thought that I have is, why did Jesus tell this to disciples? Why did he give them this information? Well, the reason why is because the information of knowing there's going to be false teachings out there. There's going to be hard times, but Christ is going to win in the end. You got to get the most important decision right. That was all information that he gave them in their current setting so they can make better choices right there in the midst of it. There are no excuses because we can all look back on choices that we made and the excuse is, I didn't know the whole story. I didn't know back then what I know now. They were not going to have that excuse because he had given them that information. And he's given that to us also. He tells us what ahead, so we're not going to be surprised by that. You know, I think about something that he said in verse 12. He says, now learn this lesson from the fig tree. As soon as its twigs are tender and its leaves come out, you know that summer is coming. In those times, people watch fig trees for the first signs of summer. No one is going to say, whoa, it's summer, it's warm outside. I didn't see that coming. Because all the signs were there with the fig tree. In the same way, we should not be surprised about any of these things. And I ask the question, since we have that information, will we take that information to make better choices in the present? You know, it's amazing how even many of us, when we have the information, you know, on what decision is best, we're still good at making the wrong choices. But we have no excuse. Jesus has clearly told us there are false beliefs out there. So critically seek truth. There's going to be hard times, but Jesus wins in the end. So have hope in the midst of darkness and make the right choices now before it's too late. We're going to go from here over the next few weeks. Jesus is going to give a series of stories talking more about how we can be prepared for his second coming, but prepared for that moment that we see him face to face. And we'll be digging into that over the next few weeks. If you join me in prayer. Father, I want to thank you for this time that we can get together this morning. And Lord, I want to thank you that on the most important things in the grand scheme of history, we're not left in the dark wandering around trying to figure this out. But Lord, you have given us these resources so that we can hold fast to you, so that we can have hope in the midst of darkness, so we can be confident in our salvation. And Father, I pray for every one of us here in this room that, first of all, give us a sense of awe and praise that you have been so generous to give us that info. But Lord, may it be people who respond to that and who take these warnings seriously. Father, we go from here. May you just bless us this week. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, may God bless you all. By the way, if you have an interest in children's ministry stuff, we're going to meet down in my office and about down that way in probably about another 5 minutes.